Okay, so welcome to this week's recitation. So this time we'll be talking about inference, and inference is honestly just a fancy word for predictions. So the idea here is that you've already trained your model, you've created that this model, and after you've created it, you've also trained it on the data that you have, right? You passed all of your images or whatever it is, and you've gotten all your weight. Yep. So as I was saying, we've already created the models and we've gotten the weights. We've gotten the weights obviously by SGD or I mean you've done all of that. And now what you want to do is that you want to use that model to predict an image that you've got to predict to classify an image that you've gotten from in the wild. Like you've just this is the model that is deployed. This is what a user is literally having access to. Like he's uploading an image and you want to classify that image or whatever your particular use case is. So that is essentially what inference is. And inference is like at the level that we are talking about, this is obviously the first steps, and here we are just trying to understand inference and how we actually do it in PyTorch. But what I want you to understand is that in the real world, when you're developing, like when a company like Amazon or a company like Microsoft is deploying their models, the only thing that they care about is actually how long it takes for inference, right? Like that is their end goal. It obviously the results have to be accurate, but at the end of the day, no user is going to wait around if no user is going to wait around for a result if it takes 5 or 10 seconds just to classify an image, or it takes 10 to 15 seconds to do any sort of machine learning task. So this is a very, very, very crucial step, and this is a very sort of this is where a lot of optimizations come in on a very on a large scale. Like when you become a machine learning engineer, if you ever become one, or if you get into ML ops, then this is one place where a lot of focus is, where a lot of focus is put on to ensure that the inference time comes down to as low as it can. It isn't uncommon for models to have inference times of, 0.02 seconds, 0.2 seconds, and stuff like that, which seems very. It genuinely seems insane, because if you just think about the scale of the models itself, right? If you think about something like GPT-3 or any such, these are trillion parameter models. Like genuine, they have 1 trillion parameters, and even more, like in some cases, right? So billions and trillions of parameters. So processing all of that data within just that small amount of time and getting out a result, that is inference. So what we're going to do right now is we've already created the model, and now what we want to do is we just want to understand on a simple level. I've created the model, I want to pass an image, and I want the result, right? So keep in mind here that we don't know the truth value of this image, right? Because this is something that a user has provided. The data that we've used to train the model, that did have those true values. That is how we trained the model. That is how we calculated the loss, and we did all of our training steps. But this is not true for the data that we've gotten from outside. So I think to a certain degree you've already gone through the training, validation, and test steps. But I think I'll just summarize it in one, just once, just so just for a refresher. So ideally the way that we do this is that we split up our data set into three chunks. One is the training set, which is typically the largest set. Then you have the validation set, and then you have the test set. So on the training set, it's obviously, you've trained the model on that set. The validation set is actually, this is where a lot of people get confused, and I cannot overstate the importance of a validation set. You do any sort of data science in the real world, the validations, you cannot afford to skip the validation set, because what happens is, once you've trained your model, you've got all of these parameters and hyperparameters, you can't just use it on the test set and then make changes back again to your hyperparameters and, you know, then say that, oh, I've gotten a better test set accuracy, right? Because the test set is supposed to be something that you have no access to at all at any stage of the process. If you do happen to do this, then what happens is there's something known as a data leak, right? So what has happened is that the data from the test set, which is ideally supposed to remain unseen, it has leaked into your model, and your model has learned those features already, which is why you're getting a higher accuracy on the test set. So it isn't reflective of the real world, and it's not the right way to go about it, creating these models. So that is why we use the validation set. We tune our hyperparameters based on the validation set, and just once, after you've done all of your tuning, after you've done all of your training, just once you run your model on the test set, and what you get is what you get. Those are your results. That is what goes into your research paper. That is what you tell your friends, tell your family, and that is what is published, right? So that is training, validation, testing, right? So here we aren't doing that. simply because, I mean, we aren't interested in that step as of now. We're interested in inference, right? So we aren't going to go there. So let's just talk about the modeling process, right? All of this you've already seen from the last recitation. What you might not have seen is this: the number of layers of the model. And you know, I think last time we just had one or two layer models, but this time we have four. And if you look at these parameters, these are like a huge number of neurons, right? So if you attended yesterday's lecture, then Swapnil talked about this a lot. You know, why do we need models with these multiple layers, with a large number of neurons? And that is what the topic of discussion yesterday was, right? So the idea is simply to increase the complexity of a model, to allow it to model more and more complex data, so that it has the best chance to correctly classify an unknown data point when it actually comes in, because it already has seen so much variety and it has this power, it has this strength to classify something that it might not have seen, and it has no idea of what features it has, right? So again, I mean, you can definitely go back and look at yesterday's lecture, and Jay is absolutely right. I mean, technically that is what it is. So you want to capture as many non-linearities as possible. So yeah. And so one thing I would like to draw your attention upon is this, because we'll be doing something with this just in the next cell. So you've gone through all of these ReLU layers, and then you end up with a log softmax layer, right? So the log softmax layer is, I think we actually covered this during the last lectures. I think Fennel went over cross entropy and all of that. So here the simple idea is that it isn't probability, right? It isn't probability. It becomes probability when you exponentiate it. So just in the next step, as you'll soon see, what we've done is we've gotten all of these log softmax values. And then in the next step, after we've passed an image through the model and we've gotten all of these log softmax values, we take their exponential to get their class probabilities. So the class probabilities always follow the rules of probability. Their sum is going to be 1, and you know, that is the only rule, right? So it's always going to be 1, and they are independent as well. So,
and just to clarify one more point, so in this case, I think we are using like negative log likelihood, which is why we are doing this log softmax. Otherwise, if you use cross entropy directly, then you don't need to have like this log softmax applied in here as a last layer. And we mostly do log based operations in order to avoid underflow and overflow situations, sort of like that. We're dealing in log spaces better compared to exponential.
Correct. correct, absolutely. So that is what we've done here. We've got this classifier, but if you'll notice that, I mean, we haven't trained it yet, right? We're just passing. We haven't done anything actually. I mean, to be honest, like it's clear, right? We haven't done anything. We just declared, declared is the word. We've declared a classifier, and all we've done is we've just passed the images through the model and gotten some sort of probability. Why have we done this? So this isn't actually something that we'll do when we are actually modeling and we are actually creating the model. This is just for explanation, right? So the actual training steps are later, just because I want to explain it in a certain way. That's all. So here what we've done is we've passed our images to the model, we've exponentiated them, and the probabilities that we get. So this is something that Deep talked about, right, in the last recitation. You pass a batch of images. So this is a batch of 64 images, and the result that you get is obviously going to be a 64 by 10 matrix. So what does that mean? You have 64 images, and for each of them, there is a certain probability that it is of, that it belongs to a certain class. So those values are that, exactly that. So the zeroth value is the probability that the zeroth image belongs to the zeroth class. So 0 × 3 is going to be the probability that, so I think it's 1 to 10. So it must be, you know, 1 indexed, not 0 indexed, but you obviously get what I mean. So 0, 3 would actually be 0, 1, 2, 3. So 3 would be the fourth, the probability that it belongs to the fourth class. So it that's what it is, right? So that is the data structure that we get out of doing this. After that, again, this is not something you're going to do when you're actually modeling. All of this is just for explanation, right? So what we do after this is we use a function called top k. So now we have a matrix of 60, I should do it this way. So 64 by 10, and each of these has a certain probability in them. So what we want to do is we want to get a matrix which has the actual probability itself, and second, the index where that highest probability was found. Why? Because that is the actual class, right? That is what we are interested in finally. But we also want that probability just to understand how correct the model thinks it has classified the image I should explain this a bit better.
Like how confident the model is.
Exactly. How confident the model is. So you want both of these things. So we use this function called top k, and this is literally what it does. You give the top probability and the top class. So you get the indices of all of the top classes, and you get the top probability as well. Now you the weird thing, right? So once you print this out, you'll see that it's just given 7 for all of them. Why? It's simply because we haven't trained our model yet. Our model isn't predicting, it isn't doing anything yet. These are just random initializations, and I'm not sure why, but it's giving 7 for all of them. This might have something to do with the type of initialization, but this is actually really interesting. I mean, I found this a bit weird as well. Why it happened to give 7 for all of them? Maybe if somebody knows why, what will the weights be initialized? Yeah, so that is something we're going to cover soon, just in the next. So initialization techniques, we're going to be covering that soon. So yeah. Okay, so this is what we're going to get. These next few steps are actually just you can go through them if you want. I don't think they're particularly relevant. We're just using these to calculate the accuracy of these predictions, which is obviously going to be pathetic because the model doesn't know what it's doing yet, right? So we're just using these steps to calculate the accuracy. Ki abhi seven aaya hai, that we've got seven, and is it correct? Is it wrong? And we're trying to find the accuracy. There are certain nuances involved in this step, simply because there are mixed data types involved, which is why these steps are important. But apart from that, there is no, you know, hidden magic or anything behind them. You can just go through the notebook, and if you read through it, there's nothing that needs to be explained explicitly here. So that is what is going to happen here, right? So let's get to the next step now. Here is where we'll actually train the model, and let's just see what is going on. So if you'll notice, again, this is not something that we do actually, right? The accuracy steps are actually embedded into the training itself. Usually that is how it happens. So when you look at the training, you want to know what accuracy I'm getting so that I can maybe stop the training at a certain point. This is something that we're going to be covering soon. So overfitting and stuff like that gets involved, which is why we need this, which is why we need these values during training itself. So the training steps, again, quite straightforward. They are actually like just logical. I mean, you've got the loss, and then you pass the images through the model. Based on the loss, you keep optimizing, SGD, gradient descent. And that is what is going on here. After this, okay, what I meant to say when I said that we won't be doing this explicitly is that we won't be doing this for one batch explicitly. I'm sorry if I was ambiguous. This is obviously a very important step, but it is embedded into the training itself. This is something that I should have enunciated much better. This is something that we do, but we do it repeatedly within the model's training itself. That is what I meant to say. So after this, you've trained the model. This is obviously, this can take X amount of time. And now we get to inference. I've told all of this stuff, and now we get to what the topic was. So correct. So this is actually it. This is all that there is to inference, where you're essentially just passing an image to the model. You're getting obviously the output that you get is obviously the log softmax, which is why what you do is you exponentiate it again, just the same way that we did it earlier. You pass the output into, so I do need to clarify something here. This is important. This notebook is adapted from Udacity's deep learning PyTorch course. Okay, so what they've done is that they've set up certain helper functions. This import helper that I've done here, and so this import helper actually comes from this, a script that they have created in order to make certain things easier, right? So I should actually just open that up. It would be very helpful. So what is going on here is very simple. Actually, you've passed it through this. You've gotten your results. You've gotten all of these probabilities and the indices. And what are you doing? You're just passing them into this one function called view classify, and this is the output that you get, which gives you the image and the probability that this image is a 4, which is, if you notice, it's very good, right? And the accuracy that we got as well were 97, 90, clearly very good. So I'll just show you the view classify method once. So this is the method that they've defined. it's essentially doing a very simple thing. It's taking in the results and the image. It's displaying the image and going through the results to find out which exactly was the highest probability and attaching them onto the image. That, okay, so this is what the highest probability was. So create a bar chart with that probability, with the value of that bar set to whatever probability that number is, right? The probability that that number is. So that is what is going on here. And yeah, I think that is all there is to inference, actually. Obviously, inference in the wild is going to be a bit different. It's not just going to be something like this, because you're going to have images coming in from users every second and you want to deal with things like that. So it is a bit different. Oh, I did miss one thing. Yes. So there are two lines here that I want to draw your attention on. So there's Torch, NoGrad, and Model Eval. So in PyTorch, there are modes that you can set for your model. So when I set it, when I call this particular line, what it does is it sets my model into an evaluation mode. Okay. And in the evaluation mode, there are certain nuances. There are certain things that get activated, certain things that get deactivated. So you must have covered dropout yesterday, right? So in the evaluation mode, the dropout layers are eliminated. They actually become dropout layers. There are a few other things, but I don't think it's, I mean, you can just look them up. All you need to know is that before you do inference, this is something that you do want to call. This is something that should be done, because it ridiculous. So there are both of these steps. They decrease your inference time multifold. I mean, manifold. So you do want to use these two things. So this second thing is Torch NoGrad. So this is something known as a context manager. What this means is that while this is happening, this is going to be set. And then immediately after this finishes executing, this is going to revert back in some way to its original state. You know, so context managers are something that you can maybe look up. Context managers, Python. This is what this is. And what this essentially is doing is that it's telling PyTorch that for this particular step, I don't need access to my gradients. I don't want the model to learn anything from this image. I just want to pass my image through this model using whatever gradients it already has. And I don't want to touch them at all. I don't want access to the gradients and I don't want to change them in any way. So that is what this step is doing. And I mean, logically, right? It makes sense. And this is clearly something that is important, because otherwise the model is going to, again, tune itself in some way. It's going to basically consider this as a training image, right? So you don't want that. So, yep, I think I'm done then. This is what is going on. If you have any doubts, then sure, just shoot them. Just put them into the chat, or maybe just unmute yourself and then we'll continue on with the rest.
Just to clarify one thing. So for Torch NoGrad, so the one important goal is like you want to don't keep a track of the gradients when you're validating, sort of, because anyway, it doesn't help you in like sort of updating a model as such like that way. And basically by doing Torch NoGrad, you are basically also reducing your memory usage like with respect to GPU. Otherwise, it will keep track of all these gradients and yeah, your memory would be used for that. So that is another reason. And for model.eval, so like using model.eval basically helps us deactivate some of the things that are used for training, like in order to avoid overfitting and all. So like the one common use case of model.eval where it is useful is sort of dropout. So we apply dropout during training, so it randomly eliminates some of the neurons. So in model.eval, it avoids that elimination of neurons and like we get a complete architecture. The other reason is sort of it is also applied for batch normalization. So where we basically during the training, we try to reduce like try to normalize our data, like basically the batches that we have, so it avoids that part like during the inference. So like these are the two reasons maybe like which is why we use model.eval, like, and yeah, so it basically deactivates all of that.
Yep. So I'll
I think we'll wait for maybe 4 to 5 minutes and we'll get back with second session till then. I'll share the screen. If anyone has any questions, then yeah, go ahead.
Yep.
Is the screen visible? I think hopefully it should be.
Yes, yes.
Is this proper or this one is fine? Is this readable enough or like should I zoom it?
Zoom it in, yeah.
Okay, till then, yep. Like, let me run some of the cells. So yeah. Till then, like, if any of you have any questions, so yeah. Once it's downloaded, we'll get started. Sorry for the delay. Okay, so like coming to overfitting, so in various scenarios, like it is a case where you do well on your training data, but like after a certain period, you tend to perform worse on your validation data. So this is an indication of like that you are basically overfitting your training data, which means that your model is just basically trying to mimic the exact output like that the training data has, like in a way, and like it is trying to predict the labels in a way. So it is not basically trying to learn sort of like what is the reason or like what is how the actual explanation behind like the prediction is. It is just basically kind of trying to copy the just labels sort of. So which is why we have this particular validation cycle where we during our training data, as we basically keep a log of like your training loss. So we also keep a log of your validation loss. So validation loss helps us basically understand like sort of where the model is generalizing well. So, and this is in a way used for like the fine tuning as well. So like you try out the like particular model. So where let's say you have different hyperparameters. So in order to find out the best set of hyperparameters that works, you basically do this validation. You keep a track of this validation loss and see like how well you are performing. So if you see for this particular diagram, so if you till you're approximately like somewhere 8 to 9 epochs, like the results are validation loss is getting decreased, but after that there's a sudden increase of the validation loss. So which means now your model is basically tending to literally imitate your training data in a way and like not learning much. So this is a good indication that you should stop by this or like keep or use this model, like the model saved at sort of where epoch 8 or 9 as your final model for inference. Like, so that is the main reason why we like basically have this particular graphs and all, like based on which we try to predict how well we are doing and like what would be our best model to put in production sort of. But coming back to this as well, like, so if you see your model here, the like difference between the training loss and the validation loss, this loss gap is getting bigger and bigger sort of like that way. And you don't want that basically. So you want your validation loss as well, like basically to reduce in a way. And so for doing this thing, you basically have like this regularization. So what you do in regularization is like, you don't directly want your training data like to just do well in, like on validation data to not do well sort of. So in regularization, you add some sort of like constraints over your model. So which basically helps you in reducing this gap sort of between the training loss and the validation loss sort of. And this in turn helps you basically generalize well on unseen data as well sort of, which the model has never seen. So there are different techniques of regularization sort of. So if you say like for in a way regularization sort of, so like there are, sorry, so this is what we have seen is sort of overfitting, and this problem is very well known in neural networks because like we have this sort of like larger neural networks, right? So having this all like stacking and all this like larger layers and all different things and making your neural networks more complex and bigger, so it helps you learn get better performance, but also it has a tendency to overfit on training data as well. So if you see the case of linear regression, so that might be the case of underfitting, so where your model is not capable enough in order to understand the actual training data or like basically learn the representation of the training data. So for like neural networks, we face this problem of overfitting. So how do we like reduce this problem of overfitting? So we add sort of some way of like regularizing this particular model parameters, which helps us in controlling or like basically this overfitting sort of the model and helps us basically reduce this gap between the training loss and the validation loss. So as you said, like regression is any modification we make to learning algorithm. Basically that is intended to reduce its generalization error, but not its training error. So that is in a way true, but the point being is, even if like by reducing a bit of generalization error, let's say like we try to reduce this gap between the training error and the validation error, right? Sort of. So we try to have this constraints on the model, so where we make the model a bit lesser effective on the unseen data, but that is still helpful, like in a way, because it would not overfit exactly the training data, because in real life situation there might be cases where your actual data you're testing on would not be drawn from the same training data distribution. So this helps us do well in real life situations. Any doubt so far? Like basically about overfitting regularization sort of. You can unmute and ask. Okay, then I'll move forward. So for regularization, there are different ways of basically doing regularization. So like basically today we'll be going through weight initialization first of all. Next is weight decay. Other is L1 regularization. And after that is early stopping and dropout. So for rate initialization, so as you have already seen in yesterday's lecture, like basically initializing your weight, how your weight are also affects your learning process. So if your weight are initialized in a well manner way, then basically your learning process would not take much time and your model will converge faster. On the other hand, if your weights are initialized basically, let's say, too off from the actual best optimal weights, then it would take a lot of time to basically go towards convergence. So there are different techniques, like over the years, like people have tried different like techniques of initializing weight, and this is more on about empirical data, like of how well these techniques work, and based on that, like uniform distribution, normal distribution, or like Xavier initialization or timing initialization. These techniques work well in real life practice, and this is much of the standards followed here. So Xavier initialization, timing initialization are more or less based on uniform distribution and normal distribution with some added functionality or like basically on top of it, which basically helps even much better to train neural networks and helps us reach convergence easily like that. So if you want to like basically dive into the individual mathematics of like how this particular initialization works, then you can look at this. I think in D2L also there's a chapter, and also like I'll provide another link as well. By default, PyTorch initializes the neural network weights using timing initialization. So this is a initialization way where PyTorch initializes. So we can look at it here. So if you see here, like basically the weight initialization technique of PyTorch using like this in NN dot linear or like whichever layer it is, they use this NN dot timing uniform distribution for initializing the weight. So that is the timing initialization. So they have this parameter span in and fan out like that way, which are used for initializing the weights. So let's try to understand like basically based on this. So let's say we initialize the neural network basically a linear layer which takes 10 inputs and outputs, like gives 2 outputs. So printing out the neural network layer. So if you see now, you have this particular uniform distribution values, like basically with the, I think between -1 and 1. So like basically where your lower bound is -1 and like upper bound is 1. But now let's say you want to initialize with basically uniform distribution. So for initializing with uniform distribution, you use the nn.init module. So this is like the main module that you will use to initialize the weight. So here you call the nn.init, and then under that you call the uniform underscore function, which basically initializes this neural network weights from a uniform distribution with minimum bit bounds between 0 and 1. So the values will be between 0 and 1. And here basically underscore implies like in place operation. So that is like here it is. So if you see now, like based on this particular values that we had initialized, so if you see like the minimum value was basically closer to 0 and the maximum value was closer to 1. So here they are like this is a bound where we are setting our weights basically. And in practice, it is basically better to have weights initialized closer to 0 in some sense, like so that you are not basically exploding a weight too much. So like that. Okay, so apart from this, so the other initialization technique is normal distribution. So here also it is the same. So here also you call nn.init and dot normal underscore call. You pass your neural network's weight, and here there are basically, so this is a normal distribution, and here by default the parameters are standard deviation 0, mean 0, and standard deviation 1. So it will draw basically values from that distribution here. So if you see here in practice, so it is closer to somewhat like that. There would be always some bit of fear in a way. So yeah, but yeah, on an average it would tend to be closer to somewhat like values of mean 0 and standard deviation 1 like that. The other like what we discussed sort of, so here the next is Xavier initialization. So nn.init.xavier_normal_, like, so this is the call you use for Xavier initialization using normal distribution like here. So here also you pass neural network layer and initialize the weight sort of. So in practice, you won't require much here basically from a weight initialization perspective, because probably by default initialization is well enough. But in some cases, like some applications, you might be required to initialize weight in specific manner, which may help you like learn better or convert your model better. So as in case of like the ResNet model, if you see, so they have like this Xavier initialization, sort of a chain initialization also on its like that. So here also, if you see, so in general practice, like basically most of the times people use like this sort of standard. So where they initialize the weight using this particular sum distribution, like whether it is uniform distribution or the normal distribution, and they set the bias sums to zero. So here currently, if you see, like we have like bias sums here, and like now we basically set it to zero, like basically some constant. This is optional. This is not necessary, but here like in the code that you might basically encounter at GitHub and all different places, this is also a usual practice, like that people set the bias sums to zero or like some constant value and like basically initialize the weight using some distribution, whether it is uniform distribution or the normal distribution. So like if I want to learn more about like this weight initialization and like in terms of mathematically, like how it enables us to like get better convergence or like quicker learning sort of, you can read this post. This post has like a detailed explanation about it, and it goes over the mathematics as well behind this initialization techniques. I will wait here for a minute if anyone has any doubts regards to weight initialization. Like in most of the cases for simple neural networks, you might not do this things, but yeah, for complex neural networks or like in your app products, you might try, you might use this things, like you will, you might require using this things. By default, initialization is also like really good. So yeah, it works well in most of the cases. Okay, so is it just trying to change? It's not exactly trial and error, but like over the, in a way you can say like basically people have tried this different combinations, and like now we have some empirical results about like, let's say for this applications related to images and all, like suppose let's say this kind of initialization works well. So yeah, it was more of a trial and error, and also like basically backed by mathematical evidence as well. But yeah, like you cannot know about like basically whether for your specific application this weight might work well or this might work well. Yeah, but people generally follow some standards on which they, for popular architectures that work well, so people try to use that for their architectures as well, their models as well. So yeah, in most of the cases I don't think you might be required to do this specifically, but yeah, it's good to know about like that there's a way of initializing this weight and in case you require it. Should I move ahead or like, so is this thing clear? You can reply in chat once. So yeah. Okay, then I will move ahead. So the next part is basically with respect to weight decay regression. So yesterday, Swapnil had talked about this. So we had sort of a constraints on our model parameters because we don't want our model parameters to basically grow larger, basically sort of like the weights are too large, which basically results in too much of in the actual prediction, sort of like resulting into that particular specific, exactly, let me draw if it's possible. Sorry, I'm not able to find out annotations, but yeah, so like basically you don't want like basically too much complex curves like that way, but you want to basically have a like a smooth curve in a way, but not too specific, sort of like where your basically predictions like go very off, basically, if there is a change in the values a bit. So which is why you basically enforce some constraints on your actual weight parameters. So by enforcing this constraints on a weight parameter, basically, this particular term like contributes to the loss. So you are in a way basically telling your model that basically don't model parameters not to grow too large. Otherwise, if they grow too large, then it will basically result in too much like higher loss, and which is why your actual performance would not be good. So you are in a way trying to basically constrain your model parameters to not grow too much while also learning something good. So this is like the reason because why weight decay is popular, and like basically we add this sort of like constraint about the on our model. So if we say like this particular weight decay regularization, so this is also known as L2 regularization, ridge regularization, or Gaussian prior. So this is Gaussian prior because we have some prior belief about like we add some sort of prior belief in our loss function, right? Basically, like we add this particular penalty parameter such that we don't want to grow too, so that we don't want our weights to grow too much later. So that is in a way we are adding some sort of prior knowledge basically that we have, and like basically due to this prior knowledge, we are enforcing our models to be have like proper weights, like not like to explode or not too small later. So if you see now your like loss function gets updated as like this is the old loss that you do normally, like the cross entropy loss or like the depending on the case, like the MAC loss, and you have this particular model parameter. Like you take the norm of that model parameter and you multiply by lambda by. So lambda is your hyperparameter tuning. So if you have like lambda equal to zero, which means that basically then you are like not doing anything about regularization here. So like you are basically in allowing your model parameters to grow as long, basically as large as they want. And like for lambda equal to infinity, you are basically enforcing your model parameter to be too small, like sort of like close to zero. So you want sort of somewhere between like that way, so which works with. And you can see here the update rule basically changes as theta equal to theta minus sort of this learning rate times this particular derivative, the gradient of this particular loss function. So here in this case, like this particular term is known as decaying sort of. So here you are decaying your weight parameters a bit. So like the overall term, like this theta minus theta times lambda theta is basically your less than equal to theta. Sort of like less than theta like that. So yeah. So as you said, also this term tries to basically push your parameters more closer towards zero in a way. So like you're not basically exploding too much, sort of. So adding a weight decay. And the reason behind like this particular, in some of the cases, like for libraries, this particular like L2 regularization and weight decay might not be exactly the same. So like in some cases they for different implementations, it might vary. So like where this particular lambda by two parameters, so some libraries consider this as just a lambda parameter. So you have to adjust it accordingly, otherwise you might get different results like using the same parameters on two different implementations too. So yeah, but for PyTorch, this is like the usual case, so where it applies as lambda by two. So we call it this as like the weight decay is the L2 regularization in a way. So for applying like the weight decay to a particular model, so what we do is basically we have this particular optimizer class, like the stochastic gradient, like the SGD class that we use. And in that case only we specify like the weight decay, so by how much amount we want to decay our weight. So this is like the parameter like that we use here, sort of. So for this term, like basically, you know, like the lambda term, like, in a way. So we decay the weights by this much sort of, and this is the learning rate as well. And also like another way for basically you to control the weight decay for different parameters might be, you can basically select sort of group your parameters differently, and you can apply like different weight decay for different parameters. So if you see like you're basically for model.name parameters, if you see we are segregating it on weights and biases, and then we are applying different weight decays for weight actual model parameters and the biases here, like the model weights and the bias. So yeah. So here we are applying weight decay zero for like the bias sum, and for actual weight parameters, like we are applying 1e minus 4. So this is like the how do you initialize and basically do weight decay in PyTorch. So using the directly using the optim.sgd class, you pass it your parameter. and for initializing the individual like specific layers, like different parameters for specific layers. So you basically pass the parameters as a dictionary with all the certain specific properties that you want to apply to that layer only, and you do it like basically that way, and like you pass all different model parameters as a list, like finally. So in this case, you can also apply different learning rates for this different weight parameters and the biases. So that is also possible. But for now, we have like kept the constant learning rate. Otherwise, you can basically do LR equal to so on. So for basically, if you want to do like from scratch, like how do you do in PyTorch the L2 penalty? So that is like, so you take some model that you have. You have this particular constant that you are basically having, right? So what do you do in this particular term is you take the norm of the parameters. So you iterate through all the layers in the model that you have. And like you take a particular layer, you find the norm of weight norm basically for norm of the model parameters here. And then you sum all the norms, like. So you then apply this particular lambda times L2 norm. So that is like the L2 penalty for your model right now, like the model parameters. So if you see right now, the model parameters are the Smith sort of, yeah. So it's very smaller right now. No, like model parameters not be smaller, but yeah, like due to this L2 lambda parameter, like your overall value gets smaller. So yeah, this like value adjusts how much like decay to apply. Is this clear or any doubts? I'll take the questions if you have any. You can unmute and ask like if you have any questions. Is this thing clear? Sorry. Could you respond in chats? Okay. So for the next part, like basically we have like, so there is a L1 regularization as well. And just one more thing to add. So you're like the cyclic learned switch regression, you have implementation. So that uses this kind of concept only for like basically finding a good linear classifier. So like this is also like derived from that like name sort of like the weighted regression sort of like. Just to add one more time. So now like we have a L1 regularization also. So in L1 regularization, it's a similar thing, but instead of the norm of the model parameters, you take the absolute value of the model parameter. So instead of the squaring term, like basically in calculating the norm, you just have like take the absolute value of your model parameter and sum it up. So this is also known as like the least absolute shrinkage selector operator. So like the Lasso regression, if you might know about that, sort of Lasso. Laplacian prior, sparsity prior as well. So here in a way, like if you see from a Laplacian distribution perspective, so then what does it enforce is sort of like you want your model parameter to be nearer to zero in a way. So like it adds more like basically sort of more value or more probability to the model parameters that are nearer to zero. So which means like you want your model to be closer, like weight parameters to be closer to zero in a way. So it's just similar thing, but like in a different manner. Like, so that's the like bit of difference about like taking the norm and the absolute value here. And if you see like for the actual derivative gradient, we just take into account the sign of the model parameters like that. Yeah. Because since it's an absolute value, right? So yeah. So like basically the only in a way the difference between L2 and L1 regularization is like, so L1 will basically completely kill the components that are close to an axis like this video in a parameter space. So like those who are basically more to you can clarify in a better moment. Okay. So like the difference in this case was like sort of the model parameters that are more closer towards each edge, sort of like the axis or the in a embedding space. So it will try to basically kill that component because that component won't help you much. Like basically it is just enforcing you in a single direction, right? So it is trying to get more evenly distribution, like sort of. So that is like basically the reason. And like basically it is bit, if you see like the L2 regularization, so L2 regularization reduces the model parameters in more evenly fashion, whereas this completely kills off the components, like basically which are more closer to the particular axis. So that's a difference in a way, like. So either of this have its own advantages, disadvantages. Some case like L1 regularization might work well, some case L2 regularization might work well. But in standard practice, like people apply this L2 regularization sort of weight decay, because this is more into incorporated into PyTorch, like sort of using this weight decay parameter, so you can directly like tell the PyTorch to do all the things behind the scenes. So if like you were to implement sort of L1 regularization or like the penalty, so how do you do about it? So it's the same part, like you iterate through your model parameters, and for each of the parameters you take the absolute value and sum them up, and then so you have all of this particular model parameters, and then you take the sum of all this model layer, like all the absolute values of basically across all layers sort of. So then you get like this L1 norm, and then basically you multiply it by a scaling factor that is a L1 lambda. So you get this particular L1 penalty. And if you see here, the L1 penalty is going to be higher in a way, because you are taking just the absolute value and summing up later. Whereas in the other case, you take the norm sort of. So which basically, since you're squaring it, so the values are between 0 and 1 sort of, so it will like basically reduce a bit like that. So if you see here, this is a parameter value. And in all the cases, you might get different values when you rerun, like basically initialize the model in a different, like again, because like every time the model initialization is a bit random, it will like draw values from a particular distribution, but you cannot get the same values. So unless until you set the seeds in a way. So which basically helps you get generate some deterministic behavior for the model. Just another way for doubt. Minute, like if anyone has any questions about L1. Okay, so do we add bias sum in L1? So here, like for bias sum that is added, so here in model.parameters, if you see that bias sum is already accounted in it. So like, let me see. So if you see model.parameters, if you print out this model dot, sorry, list, you know, it is a generator. Sorry. So if you see model.parameters, you have like, so this, in this case, your bias sum is also incorporated in it, like, so there are just different parameter values, and like for like different parameters, so let's say this is like the weight values and this are the bias sums like with regard to that particular parameter. So like you get sort of this weight bias like for layer wise sort of, and then you apply this, and like, yeah, bias sum is added in penalty as well, and as well for norms as well. So both of these particular penalty calculations, like bias sum, added included. And if you want to find out like how much, what is like how many parameters are there in your model, so you do, I think, yeah, it is something like this for params and model dot parameters, you do param dot numl. So you find out the number of elements in a particular model layer, and then you sum up like all these numbers. So if you see for this particular model, we have like this particular parameter. So like somewhat 242K parameter, somewhere like that, somewhat related to close to 243K. So this is a very small model, but nowadays like the models are very large, like sort of in trillions. So we need all this particular regularization, because otherwise it would highly overfit the training data. And we don't know like whether the actual test data that is there, like is it drawn from the training distribution or not. That is not in our hands. So we want to have like this particular somewhat trade-off between like not learning too much well in training data, but also doing well on like validation set. Is your doubt clear, Sai, about like penalty? Bias sum. Okay. And also one more thing, like I would like to show. So if you want to get like the parameters with respect to the name, like sort of like what the layer is sort of, so you can do that way too. So for you, if you do model.name parameters, it would give you two values. So it would give you, so if you do model.name parameters, so it gives you tuple value. So that is like the first name associated with the layer and then the parameters. And then you can print a name here, like basically. So let's say, so if you see here, like if it is fc1.weight, fc1.bias, fc2.weight, fc2.bias. So like it is the order in which like the model parameters, you get access to the model parameters and you apply like basically this norms, L1 or L2 norm, like for each of this parameter. So the another popular technique that we have here, like this early sorting. So in early sorting, what do we do? So it is a way of basically finding out the best model setting like that works on. So like the model parameters that works well on like basically the validation data, like so on which we want to find out a hyperparameter or something like that. So what we do in basically early sorting is basically we keep a track of, let's say we like run the model for like n epochs, but during that n epochs, we also keep a track of like the best model itself. Like, and if we don't like, let's say improve upon our best prediction for long, then we can like directly stop the training process, because then it is mostly, in most of the cases, it is true that your model won't learn much, like won't improve and like is not learning anymore. Like, so like whatever learning the model has to do has been done, like sort of in a way. So here the example where the following example that is there. So here basically it has like early stopping with 5 epochs, sort of like for 5 epochs. So which means that it will basically perform the training. It will keep a track of the best accuracy. If your model basically does well, or let's say on current epoch, it will keep a track of it and save the current model like basically. And let's say if your model doesn't do well, so then it will keep a track of the counter. So if you pass that amount of count, then it will directly break the training, like stop the training. Because then you were like, it is a bit of, you can say, a trade-off between like sort of the accuracy and like the amount of time you want to spend on training. Like sometimes in most of the cases, this is like, this works very well because it is evident sort of like if you would see as Swapnil as well showed yesterday. So there's this gradient like curve sort of, so then like there are very low chances that your like training would improve, like validation loss would like be lower and lower and your model would perform better like once it has like stopped to do it. So like that double descent case is very less and not much use, like sort of, so yeah. But again, that is dependent on like the computer resources too, because like current models are too heavy, so people don't like have like sort of that computation budget to spend on like risk in order to see whether it will improve in future or not. So this is why they use this sort of early stopping like setting for finding out like sort of the best model and stop if there is not much improvement after certain time, certain epochs. So this is only the logic that you need to write for early stopping. And yeah, we'll see all of this in action, like basically after like going through all, like we'll like incorporate all of like these things as much as possible in like your neural network and see if it works well or not. So the next thing in this case is dropout. So this is like the most common technique, like basically, so like out of all the techniques that I've shown here, so like dropout and early stopping are kind of the most common techniques that people use. So here basically what dropout does is sort of it randomly zeros some of the neurons, sort of, or like basically in a way it kind of drops off the neurons during the training, and then basically your model has this sort of your model is basically now a cleaner model, sort of like not having all these neurons, sort of, and your model has to learn, sort of. So this is in a way used to basically enable the each of the neurons to be expressive enough so that like your actual prediction is not highly dependent on a single neuron. Let's say if one neuron fails in case of like in some case, then basically your other neurons contribute the same thing and like you are able to do well and like predict well. So that is the reason behind the dropout. And for doing dropout, so let's say if we have dropped this particular like in this case, if you see, we have dropped like two layers, sort of two neurons, sorry, H2 and H5. But we want here the output, basically what, like, let's say if this was like the actual network. So we want like the expectation of this network to be same. So what do we do in this case is we scale up the output parameters in this case here. So after passing through a dropout, we scale the output parameters. So like such that it behaves as similar to like it is basically drawn from this particular neural network. So we try to have like the same expectation in a way. And for doing basically for implementing the dropout in PyTorch, like we use an n.dropout module. So like this is a module basically directly. So what do we do in this case? We pass out the probability value. So like that probability value indicates how much percentage of neurons we want to drop in each layer. Let's say like the layer we applied. So let's say here, like if we see, so out of the 5 neurons, we have dropped 2 neurons. So the probability here is 2/5 for that case. So like 0.4. And if you want to basically write, let's say dropout in your model. So let's say this is a simple model that we had last time, right? So we have this particular linear layer one and next is another linear layer. And what do we do in this case is dropout sort of. So we apply a dropout with the probability of 0.2. So that means we will drop 20% of neurons like in any layer that we apply the dropout to. So here we, for applying the dropout is the same. So we first like calculate the actual activations and all that we have, and then we pass it through a dropout layer. So it will add like basically zero values for the neurons that it has decided to drop off randomly. So that is the case. And one more point to think, basically in this case is like, you don't want to apply dropout to your output layer, final layer. Because in this case, like if you apply a dropout to our output layer, then your predictions won't be consistent because there would be some layers dropped off and you won't get the actual probability in a way for all the classes. So this is a side note, like not to apply a dropout on the final output layer. You can apply a dropout to the intermediate hidden layers that you have. And here, like as Aryan also said, like we use model.eval. So like model.eval, what does it does? So it basically turns off this dropout part sort of, because you won't write this model again for validation separately, right? You want single model as well, like to work well on training and validation. So like this is the way we use. So by enabling this model.eval, so it basically turns off this dropout layer in a way. So which means like it just sets the dropout probability to zero. So simple way to think about it. And then again, like during turning on, like you just basically enable your dropout with the value that you had initialized sort of. So yeah. And again, here as it sets sort of, so with torch.no-grade, so it is used just to keep like reduce the memory usage basically and avoid like the unnecessary tracking of the gradients that are not necessary for our model and like will not be using for updating the model parameters like as it is. So now let's basically try to incorporate all of these things or what we have learned so far and build a neural network and let's see how well we do on it. Now till then, like if anybody has any questions, I'll wait for a minute or two. Then we'll jump into the coding part. You can unmute and ask. Like this also has like a bit mathematical explanations as well why it works well, but yeah, like on intuitive manner you want each neuron to be expressive enough so that your predictions are not highly relied on a single neuron. But yeah, like the paper is good to read, so yeah, definitely give it a read later on when you're free. Any doubts? Okay, then I will move forward. So yeah, again here for like the layers that like the network we had. So this is the same part again, like we are using the same network like 4 layers, starting with 784 inputs and like outputting your 10 like the classes, like the probability for that. So here basically we apply like initialize your dropout using nn.dropout class, and basically here we pass it the probability value here. So now for as we see, like we have to flatten the layer, so that is like we need to flatten the layer because we images are 28 by 28, so we want like just a single vector of 784, like that is a 28 times 28, right? So we flatten it, and then we apply the dropout to the individual like hidden layer sort of FC1, FC2, FC3. So applying dropout is the same thing like calling self.dropout and passing the actual output that you have like after like basically doing the activations and like the linear transformation. So yeah, basically that's a leak. We are applying leaky relu. You can also try different other activations. Like yesterday, there was leaky relu as well, sort of. Yeah. So it's a bit like it doesn't like directly like drops off after like basically in negative when it is negative. So it has like some slope, sort of alpha value there. So yeah. So this is our saving part, and like you're calculating the log softmax like as Arduino said, sort of. And here basically we are calculating across dimension one. So that is we want like basically like this thing to apply across the class probabilities, not actually across the batch dimension. So we want to apply it across the class dimension, which is why I applied dimension one. So for this particular case, since we have used your log softmax, so like we'll use your the NLL loss, so that is a negative log likelihood. And we are basically doing the same thing, initializing a model using like this. We are transferring the model to GPU, like the device, whatever we have right now. And again, we are basically transferring the loss function as well to the particular device, like the criteria. And here we'll be using the Adam optimizer. So it is a better version of SDD. So yeah, it helps us in convergence a bit better, and it has like a bit better rule to update the weight parameters, like which results in quicker convergence, sort of. So we apply the Adam optimizer learning rate of 1e3 minus 3, and we apply the weight decay of 1e minus 4 to all of the model parameters here. So again, you can apply like the model weight decay for like separate parameters and like try it out how it affects your model. Does it leads to better generalization or not, or like that way. So we'll be training for 30 epochs. Here, like the steps is just to count out like how many steps we are like doing in this case. So that's the, yeah, this is just to keep a track of the average loss sort of counter. Next is the best accuracy, sort of like this is for early stopping. So we keep a track of the best accuracy, and we update our best accuracy if like the model is well, sort of, and the patient sort of here. So that is the early stopping patients that we have. So for now, we'll basically stop the training if like the model doesn't do well on the validation data for five consecutively. So here for the training loss and the testing loss, we are keeping a track. And here, as it is said, sort of, first we discard is completely the training part. So what we do is in training part, we iterate through the batches. We get the images and the labels for that particular batch. We transfer the images and the labels to the GPU. For like training, as it was mentioned by Finil as well last time, optimizer.0 grad is compulsory, because otherwise you will be accumulating your gradients, and like you won't get a proper gradient exactly, and like yeah, you won't do well in a way, because your gradients would be sort of an accumulation of the overall gradient, like previous calculations as well, sort of. So you want to flush out the gradients every time in a way. Then we calculate the log probabilities, because here we have log softmax. After that, like applying like this criterion, and after that we perform the backward pass, so which basically calculates the gradient for the leaf nodes based on the forward competition graph that is it has like seen. And then once that is done, like we update the parameters using optimizer.step. And here we are just keeping a track of the running loss, like so loss.item will just give you the value of the item, like basically sort of like for that particular tensor in a way. So yeah, it's just a normal value in a way, like you can think of. So for actually accessing the individual item values, you can do like loss.item. So let's say if this was an array, so you can do like loss, index it, and like dot item, right? Let's say something like that. And this is the validation side. So we are basically seeing how well we are doing on like training data. Sorry, validation data or unseen data. So here again, like this is just parameters to keep a track for loss and accuracy. For this particular tall shot MOGAD, so we like turn off the gradients to save memory computations as well as avoid unnecessary gradient tracking, like, so which basically speeds up a bit and the model validation sort of phase. And again, enabling the model.eval, because we want to turn off this dropout layer basically during the evaluation. Again, the same part as the training loop. In this case, we just avoid like the optimizer.0 grad. that's it. We keep a track of, we want to basically know how well we are doing, like in terms of the loss function. So we like do the calculate the loss, but we don't perform the backward computation for this particular loss. So that's the only difference in validation and retraining. And then like apart from that, we keep a track of this. So here, since we got this particular log probabilities, so we again exponentiate it to can get the actual probabilities. After doing that, we find out the actual top probability and the class responsible for that particular associated with the probability here. So doing this ps.topk will give you both. So like highest probability as well as the class associated, like the index associated with the value. And this is just a way of like, you are just basically finding out a Boolean value sort of like. So if your, let's say your predicted value or label is correct, is equal to the actual label, then it will be true. Otherwise it would be false. And then you are just counting how much, like out of all the predictions that you have, like how much is true in a way sort of. So that is this particular dots.mean part. And yeah, as it is said, like for some of the calculations, you require specific data types. So you need to convert it accordingly. Because this is a Boolean value, so you cannot operate like mean part on Boolean. So you convert it to float, tensor, or integer, whether like that integer or like float would work in this case. Again, like as you have like basically did this, again, you enable the model in train mode, so which basically activates your dropout layer for the next training loop, training pass sort of. So that is like this. And here we are just like keeping a track of the loss and like printing out some of the useful stuff which would help us basically get an idea about how well we are doing. And this is just the same code as we have already. So if accuracy, if we do well, then we want to save that model. So like we save the model and we keep a track of the accuracy that we did sort of well on. And we basically reset the counter, like the patients, to zero again. If we don't do well, then we increment the patients counter. And if it reaches the actual patients that like the that we have already set, then it will directly break the training loop. So let's start. And just to give a side note, like this results might be a different based on like different runs, but yeah, on an average, it should be something similar. Does anyone have doubt in any of the part that I've showed, like in code? You can tell me. I'm happy to go through it again. So as you can see, currently we are improving sort of. Let's see. And in cases also, like basically here we are keeping a track of best accuracy sort of. In certain cases, you just want to keep a track of the like losses. And in that case, if your like loss is lower, then you want to like save the model. So that is the case. But yeah, keeping a track of accuracy or like losses or different other metrics depends on the application itself. For now, we have this like doing applying early stopping based on the accuracy. Anybody has any doubt? Shurinil, you have any doubt? I think your mic is down.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, ma'am. Sorry.
Yeah, I'm not sure. So as you can see, currently you are improving a bit. So like this is the best value that you had right now. So like for two epochs, you haven't done anything better than that. So let's see if it doesn't do well for three consecutive epochs again, then it would stop. But yeah, like as you see now, it has got better accuracy. So let's see. And currently, because like for early stopping, this might not be much in a way sort of representative for this particular use case, like much not helpful like that way, because your training for 30 bucks won't take much longer. But if you have parameter like models that are like trillion parameters, so like which takes, let's say, on an average and more than hours, like basically to train just an epoch. So during that time, you like will see the importance of this early stopping. So you don't want to waste your resources if you are not doing any well, sort of. So that is like the way about this. Let's see. And the results would be a bit fluctuating, right? So yeah, sometimes it might stop early, sometimes it might not even. So yeah, let's see. Because like it depends on like the random sampling of the batches that contributes to gradients. Like probably I think we will stop now, because yeah, like if you see here, this is the best that we had like so far, and after that we didn't do any better than this sort of. So like after 5 epochs we have stopped the training. So now if you see this particular loss curve sort of, so if you see this particular way, so then this is the training loss and the validation loss sort of. So by adding this regulation, you are basically enforcing some constraints on your training and validation losses, like in a way. So you want your like losses to be like gap between them to be closer, sort of. Yeah. In some cases, like yeah, this can be still better improved by like basically doing more hyperparametric tuning and fine tuning. So yeah, but this is also a demo to show like that. Bit. So you see now, like basically adding this regression, like adding this sort of inconsistency in the model, so like it results in a higher training loss now, and like the validation loss, it's a bit lower compared to. So this is like, but yeah, this is like this fine hyperparameters that we have used like not much, but yeah, we can try different hyperparameter settings and see how it impacts like this curve and like how it turns out to be. Again, as it is set sort of for inference, like it's the same part. So we, let's say we have saved this particular best model right now. We have like, right? So this is like basically the best model that we have, like the model.pth, right, currently. So we want to use this particular best model that we have, and like we want it to make the prediction on like the new data that it will see, sort of like. So for using that, so we'll load the model using model.load state dict. So it is like loading the model state dictionary, sort of, which has like basically this info about all the model parameters and the values for the associated parameters here, right, sort of. So it will load here. It will transfer the model to the like GPU or CPU based on like the device. It will then apply the model in evaluation mode. Here we are just using a particular test loader only to see how well we are doing. But yeah, in actual practice, it might be some different images right away. So yeah, and we are just sampling one image. We are just basically taking a random sample like batch, and out of that particular batch, we are just basically taking a single image. We are converting it into a single vector of 784 1D and applying it to model. So here we do model.forward and image.toDevice, because your images and the label should be on the same devices. But again, in this case, we specifically do model.toImageDevice, and like we don't want this output also to be on the same device, right? So like we don't apply the labels as labels.toDevice. The reason being for that, basically, let's say if you have plotting and all different things, so they are like basically done using NumPy sort of. So they rely on NumPy sort of. So they don't like use PyTorch tensors. So if we use PyTorch tensors, and we'll need to convert it to first NumPy and then basically do it on it. So as it is said right now, like this is the basically probability that we have. Apply exponentiation. And like then we just apply it to this helper function, and like yeah, it gives us the class probability for this particular prediction that it has made. So as you see, like it has like really high prediction here, close to 100. Like other would be a bit minor prediction, but that might not be in a way reflective in this particular one. So if you might see again another let's say image, so this is like 2. So yeah, it is now predicting right. So this is like how you do like apply all this particular regularization techniques. in order to enforce some constraints on your model so that you do not overfit on your training data. So this is all it for like today's recitation. If you have any questions or any doubts, like one more thing sort of, so this material that we had used sort of, it's based on Yoda, so it is PyTorch course. So we had applied like this, we borrowed notebook materials from them as well as like basically this particular deep learning course by Alfred McKenzie and sort of, so like the overfitting and regulation section from that. So yeah. Any questions? Okay, so for hyperparameter tuning, do we need to run the model for each time for a set of hyperparameters, or is there any automation that we can do? So like in normal PyTorch, you can't do any automation directly, but there are other tools available. Like if you see Optuna is like their one tool where it's a library where you can do hyperparameter tuning like basically. So it is basically, it supports PyTorch. So if you see, this is like the library that supports the hyperparameter tuning using PyTorch. But yeah, if you want to try it out using just the PyTorch, then you will have to try it out like different parameters and run it and like see which one works well. So yeah, they have, I think, like examples as well. So it might be a good way to go about it. So yeah, this is like their way of like doing this. So you like see sort of like how you want to see whether you are doing well on like just a single layer, or like you want to go it for three layers to like sort of like that way. So you try out this different parameters and like see. And again, in each of the layers as well, like how much neurons you should have like sort of. So yeah, this particular parameter library is very good. But yeah, like PyTorch doesn't support out of the box hyperparameter tuning. You can definitely check out this, like they have like good tutorials as well. So yeah. But yeah, I would first focus on like understanding the key concepts and the importance of what all these particular parameters are. And then you can like basically, once you understand all this parameter and all these things, then you can like just play around with libraries and like basically see how it works. Yeah. Is this clear? I have shared the actual link in the chat if you want to go through it. Yeah, but it would assume some of like prerequisites with PyTorch, like it would show demos with CNNs and all different things. So like, so that is again, yeah. But yeah, this is the library that you do. But again, one more thing, like in this case, like I think it's much suited for like the PyTorch. For scikit-learn, they have a bit workarounds, but yeah, it's a bit, you need to do like a bit more on like for running it on scikit-learn. But yeah, you can run, I think, this library again with scikit-learn as well. So. Is there any doubt, or like maybe you can unmute and ask? I think today's material we mostly focus on like understanding sort of like about how do you avoid this overfitting. These things would be more useful like in later on like recitations when we'll basically introduce more new topics such as CNNs and RNNs and all different things where the networks are more complex, and this would be more evident there, like sort of adding this particular like all this techniques of avoiding overfitting would like really help you do well. But I can say definitely try it out, like just trying different hyperparameter settings and like maybe applying, let's say, as your had shown in a demo sort of like, so you can apply different parameters based on weights and biases too. So you can try it out how that impacts your model as well. So yeah, again, trying out different weight decay settings as well. Like, so does it help more like having higher weight decay or lower weight decay, sort of what is the best balance that you can have sort of. So you can try it out different things. You can like have a plots and get more out of this recitation by doing this. So yeah, that would be a good exercise for it, guys. I will stop the recording.